And I think it's extremely important to understand this stuff, and I'll go over it with you, try and demystify it so it doesn't freak people out when you're trying to do this kind of thing. But it's very important because, like he was Travis was saying, when you're doing your creatures, you need the believability factor. You don't want to have the bendy elbows and all the different things that don't make sense, because if it doesn't make sense, you're going to lose your audience. So what I'm going to do today, I'm going to go over some tips, kind of explain how I go about certain things, and try and get through a little demo and using those tips, and see how far we get with that. So let's just start with these tips. Find them here. So tip number one, how the muscles, tendons, bones react when horses galloping or lions attack gazelle. Read this. So basically you want to know what is going on underneath the skin, how that stuff's working. And one thing I go back to when I'm doing this is the animation. It's basically animation 101. It's basically squash and stretch. Your muscles are moving back and forth. Basically, here we go. So this, hold on, let me get another one here. So these muscles here, when this dog is moving this leg up, what is going on with all this stuff? What is going on with all these muscle groups? And it's pretty simple. You have to understand where your insertion and your origin are. Figure out where all the muscle groups go. And once it moves, it's basically, like I said, the simple squash and stretch. When you stretch that out, it's going to be like that. It's a simple concept. But a lot of people don't figure out how to do it. So that's for reference. Let's go back to that. My second tip. Yeah, and this second tip. Like, let's say you want to do a kudu. Well, I have the picture of the oryx here. So we're going to bring that up. Give me a sec here. Let's bring one in that hasn't been drawn over yet so you can kind of figure it out. So let's say you want to do this oryx, and your art director's telling you, all right, you have to be, you know, believable. Okay, great. You get a bunch of reference, and maybe they want this pose. So you're looking at this stuff. You're looking at all this muscles like, wow, where do I even begin? First, look at this scapula here. You see this shape? You can see the shape of the scapula. Have your triceps here. You just take a minute, take a deep breath, look at the page. And then you want to get some good anatomy reference first to hold on to. This is from Animal Anatomy for Artists. And I marked it up here, trying to figure out my own measuring method. That's probably good for you guys to do, just try and block out, because some people think differently, and I measure it out the way I do. But you take this basic thing, then you can go back to your antelope here, and like, okay, saw my deer ref. Now I can incorporate that to my antelope here, even though it's not the same exact animal. They're both ungulates, so you should be able to figure out kind of, okay, you know, the deer doesn't have this hump, but he has the same muscle structure. So you kind of match it up, and you can bring those together like that. So here's I mapped it out. So this is a really good thing to do. So you have your deer anatomy ref that you found either through books or whatever. And it's great to have like that side view of a deer, but there's a lot more you need to know. And what I like to do is here's some dissection photos. Maybe if you guys are really into your anatomy, maybe go to the butcher shop during a hunting season and ask if you can take pictures. Because it's really important to see like how this stuff works. Like here's a sartorius. You're gonna, with a deer and the horses, you're not going to see the sartorius. You're going to see the tensor fascia, but you might be, you might think this is a sartorius, but looking at all of the anatomy ref you can get, that is actually going to be the tensor fascia. The sartorius is going to be underneath that. But for your canines in your cats, that shape there is a sartorius. So it's things like that that are really important to understand when you're doing your anatomy. Let me bring this guy back up. So once you have all that stuff, you can start mapping out, and you go back and forth, look at your different reference, look at all your books, like, okay, I see in my anatomy book, I see this shape. It's my clido-occipitalis and my omotransversarius. Like they both go in with each other here, but it creates this one shape. And when you're looking at, okay, I want to sculpt this. What is this shape here? Go back to your anatomy ref, find it. It's like, okay, that's my it's my vastus lateralis, and that is underneath my gluteus medius, which is here, and my biceps that wrap around it. And then this is the tensor fascia that comes over top. So really take your time. Here's trapezius, here's a rhomboid. It's really good exercise to do this whenever you get a chance. Just pull up any picture of any animal, try and figure it out, and you're gonna learn a ton. Like, let's just pull this up. Here's a deer. I mean, this is really good ref. You can really see. Got your scapula. Right there's the spine of the scapula. There's your triceps. There's your pelvis. Right there's your top of your femur coming down to your patella there. These are your biceps over here. Is your vastus lateralis.
Steve, when you were first learning animal anatomy, when you first teaching yourself, kind of working through it,
Well, I couldn't find anything, so that's pretty much why I started doing stuff like this. I started creating my own. Like, I went through the internet. It's really good to use. You know, you just type in, let's say you wanna get your deep muscles for your deer. You type in a good one is a cow anatomy, because there's a lot of that for veterinary stuff. So there's tons and tons of good pictures on cow dissections, and it's the same thing. You can extrapolate that anatomy to your deer, because it's the same type of animal. You see this, and here's another example of See, you can just take a picture, start blocking it out, mapping it out, different muscle groups. And it's really important to get the basics of this stuff. You don't have to know all the names. I don't know half the names. I forget them all the time. That's why I write them down like this. But you got to understand where they start and where they stop. It's really important to make believable creatures and animals. And I'll go over that. I'm going to use that for silhouette in a second. And here's another dog anatomy. See, you can see the sartorius here, and then this tensor fasciae over here. So, let me pull up. There's so many things to go over with this stuff, it's hard to... I mean, you could go on for days. But let's just focus on this back leg here for a sec. Let me just use a brush here. Now you see this area here? This, how this creates this shape. You might think that's the muscle shape, but it's actually this muscle goes all the way over to here. And what's creating this shape here, and this is why you really need to get a little deeper with your anatomy understanding, is let me put this in Photoshop so I can draw over it. Actually, you can see it here a little bit. Like right here, you can see how the muscle keeps going this way. But then you're going to see this right here. That's the fascia going over this muscle group. And that's depressing this area. So when he's tensing, this area is going to pop, and this is going to stay flat. So that's how you create those different types of shapes within the muscle groups. And that's the kind of stuff that will take you to the next step and really, really make your sculptures come alive. And like we were saying earlier, the deeper muscles, like you're not going to, this is going to be covered by this this vastus lateralis here. It's going to be covered up by this muscle encompasses this whole thing. But when he's, again, this goes back to squats and stretch, when he's moving this leg up, this is going to create a really prominent shape, and it's going to punch out from, let me keep scooting around, from this shape. And that's why it's really important to understand these different muscles. And let me bring up this This horse is a good example of kind of squash and stretch and muscle groups. So here it's really all this stuff's really getting scrunched up. So it's like, what is going on here? You know, where, what are these muscle groups? You know, what is all this stuff? Well, I found a picture of a horse galloping. Wow. Oh, don't use that one just yet. Where did I put that? Oh, it's in there. I just might as well use it. So you see this, I'll put in Photoshop again. There you go, that's the one I wanted. So you're looking at this, you're like, where do I even start? You know, how am I going to break this down? This is, you know, how can you even begin to understand what these are? Again, you go back to, you get your basic anatomy charts with horse. There's a ton of info. These are taken from a horse dissection online. You can really see what's going on underneath, really get the shapes. I'm sure you all know this guy. This is Dietrich, and this stuff, yeah, it is a gold mine, this book. I'm sure if you guys don't have it, you have to get an animal anatomy for artists. And try to buy it. Don't just lift it off the internet. Help these guys out.
But, Steve, a quick question for you. If you're looking at a Mahler's portfolio, a student's portfolio, what do you think has more value? Because it's interesting taking a look at just that picture you have up right now. Mm-hmm. With the picture you have up right now, it's very easy to see how a CG horse in motion loses its realistic appeal, because as a Mahler, you're going to be able to use blend shapes, but you're never going to be able to get the luxury of time or the budget to do that many blend shapes. So you're always kind of making that choice of sacrifice, like, what muscle groups do I choose to show? How do I go about it? So if you were looking at a student's portfolio, or you were looking at a Mahler applying for a job, so to speak, for animation, or a Mahler applying for a job for toy manufacturing, so to speak, collector manufacturing production, which do you think has more benefit? Should, you know, I show you two or three different characters, a human, a horse, a dog, or would it be equally as valuable to see a horse in three different poses and show me that you understand how those muscles are going to manipulate and which muscles show? That's a pretty big question, I know, but
If I was looking at a portfolio, I'd want to see some sort of human anatomy, you know, a guy, you know, swinging a sword or something, and then, you know, seeing how the anatomy works. With a horse, you know, I really don't want to see it static. I want to see one moving. So, I can see that you have a basic understanding of squash and stretch and where everything's going. It's going to take you. What I'm finding is a lot of guys are coming out of school technicians. They know the programs to a T, a lot more than I do. You know, I barely can understand these programs. But you're lacking in the basics of just understanding anatomy and like forms, composition. So I would really recommend anybody, you know, really try and go take a step back and understand the anatomy, because everyone's going to know the program. When you're looking for that job, everyone's going to know it to a T. They're going to have know how to map. They're going to know how to do all that stuff. What's going to set you apart is, you know, they're going to see, you know, you can do an amazing horse, and they're like, all right, you know, that's my guy. Because the other guys, you know, they kind of fudge it. They just, you know, they'll throw something together, and they can't wait to put their skin textures and scales and, you know. But you take your time to really learn this stuff. It's you're going to go to that next level, because you know you want to be an artist. You don't want to just be a technician, you know, pumping out the programs. And they are important. You do need to know them. But yeah, it's. For me personally, I think it's important, and I think, you know, if you want to be a good artist, it's the basis of any kind of art. When I went to art school, the first thing we did was anatomy and life drawing. You know, some days like 8 hours a day. You know, it's brutal, but you learn, and that's I really, you know, would suggest you guys do that. So with that. What you do, okay, you want to learn your anatomy. You have your picture here. You have your all your reference books. You have everything, you know, ready to go. You want to figure out how to do this. Figure out where the top of your pelvis is. Try and find out where the greater trochanter is, your femur, ischium back here. Okay, I kind of got the gist of where my skeletal structure is. Now you see this shape here, that's showing where my gluteus superficialis is, and there's my gluteus medius. Right here's biceps coming over, and it's not just one shape. The biceps in a lot of these animals, they kind of radiate out. Even though it looks like it's a different muscle, it's the same muscle, but a different head of the muscle. And now, okay, here's the tough part. Like, what is going on in here? You try and break it down. See this line here? That's a tibial band. Let's bring up. Bring up Dietrich's horse here. That shape is this right here. That tibial band goes down all the way. You don't see it here. See, that's another thing. You know, great reference. It doesn't show you everything. This tibial band goes all the way down to here. And then it separates this section with this section of the tensor fascia. And so that's what you're seeing. There's that section, and there's the other section of tensor fascia. And the gluteus superficialis wraps around the gluteus medius here. So that's that shape along with the tensor fascia here. And I don't know if you can see this. I'm really marking this thing up. This shape here is your vastus lateralis that's popping out from underneath. Now, you're probably like, what is he talking about? This is going crazy. This, you just break it down. You just break down the shapes. You know, you just take your time. Let's just look at this guy real quick. All right, what am I looking at? Look at your horse reference again. This is my... See this here? That's my, I think that's my semitendinosus. Here's my biceps again. Here's my bicep comes up over here. And maybe that looks like my top of my pelvis. Maybe this is my gluteus medius. Here's my gluteus superficialis. It's hard to tell what this is, but that looks, you know, like vastus lateralis. So it's good to take some time, look at that. You can see, you know, there's your masseter, zygomatic arch.
Do you find a
tricep?
Do you find that doing the drawl overs is actually, in the beginning, does that help you memorize the names for yourself? Because I notice a lot of people, they're really, really powerful anatomy as they're drawing it, whether they're speaking to somebody else or not, they kind of just read it out. Is that helping secure it in your own mind?
Or? Yeah. Just a repetition and just doing it, just the hand-eye coordination of feeling it out. You know, any way you can, like, try and memorize this stuff and just constantly, when you're looking at animals, you know, you're watching a dog, you know, walk down the street, just kind of watch how his thigh moves and watch how the, you know, I'm always curious about that. It's one thing about being an artist. You should always be curious about the world around you. And so with this guy, so now we saw that. You can see your gluteus medius. It's my superficialis wrapping around. So that's my superficialis, tibial band. It's my tensor fascia. It's my vastus popping out from underneath. There's my different biceps. I'm going to change my modifier, like having a little smoother. There's your tibialis wrapping around. A lot of times, like, I'll see muscles like this, like guys will sculpt out this muscle and they won't know where it starts and where it finishes and starts looking strange. Like, you might, like, all right, here, yeah, I kind of see there's a muscle there. Let's just attach it here, And, you know, the audience might not know that it's incorrect. It'll just feel incorrect to them. And again, you're going to lose them. And one more thing before I keep moving on, I got to move on here, is like I was saying before, the inflection points, your pivot points, your joints are huge in the believability of your animal sculptures. You really should hunker down and know where all these are going. So here's my femur, got my patella up here. It's my tibia down here. It's my ligament attaching them both. And I know where my biceps kind of fade out, fan out here, and they fan out into like fascia around here. Same thing with this. I got my patella, femur, got my tibia here. So let's go to the next tip. Keep it moving here. Any questions?
Here you go. Could you stand up? Just pass that down.
I was just going to ask, you obviously have a real understanding of how these muscles work. It's kind of an evident in what you're saying. So how did you get beyond just identifying the muscles and really understanding the mechanics of what muscles are coming into play with certain types of action? Because that's, I would think, what you're saying you really need to know in order to make these things believable.
Yeah, one of the big things, like I said, is the simple principle of squash and stretch, and the insertion and origin is huge because, let me find a...
Seems to me that there's a huge value in teaming up with a good animator and that knows their anatomy as well.
All right, let's just use this guy. So, all right, you have your basic pose here. So what you want to do, so you want to understand how they move, like when it's in action. Let me find a different one. use this guy. So. Dynamesh this real quick. I'm addicted to Dynamesh, by the way. It's the sculptor in me.
Thank
the
you.
Traditional Pixabot. Sculptor. So okay, you understand the basic anatomy, where the muscles go. So I start scribing in. All right, there's going to be where my pelvis is, my gluteus medius, superficialis, got my biceps. Vastus popping out here. What I like to do when I'm starting to sculpt is I just kind of pop up like some mounds, but I'm not just doing it randomly. They're going where I want my muscle groups to go, and I'm always thinking about the origins and insertions, meaning where the muscles start and stop. Like, I know my gastrocnemius, or my calf muscle. So let's say here's my patella. My patella should be up a little higher. Should all be up a little higher. So my patella's there. Here's my femur. Not my ligament. Tibia. So I'm trying to visualize where my femur is in here. Here's the top, here's the bottom, so I got, it's like right here. My gastrocnemius attaches right around here. So I'm thinking that in my head, I'm visualizing, okay, it's there. Using my brush here a sec. So once you have that you know that that's where that's attaching, and it's pushing pressure on this. Again, back to squash and stretch. Like, this is being pushed, this muscle's being pushed up, this is being scrunched, this muscle's being tensed. And a good way to do this is, like, go back to the horse thigh and try and sculpt, take a picture, you know, use this picture and sculpt what you're seeing, you know, copy this exactly. And that way you're going to slowly learn, you know, copy from life, copy from pictures, you know. And another great thing is, if you're not having trouble with trying to grasp it, is you want to copy old masterworks, like Anahia Huntington, Anton Louise Baer. You know, find some masterworks and try and copy how they did it. There's a lot of great monuments out there, just beautiful stuff. Look how they did it and copy their sculpture, and that's a great way to start. But going back to how to do it when they're in pose like this. So you got all your, you basically figure out where your bone structure is. I'm gonna block it out a little more here. Get your bone structure, and then that's going to tell you where your muscles go. Like I said, with the gastrocnemius here, okay, I know it attaches right here. I know my semitendinosus wraps around here and attaches right around this section here. So you just start blocking it in, moving around. You know, don't worry about being too cute with stuff right now. Just keep pushing it around. But it's all about location and figuring out exactly where things are.
So you're just getting as close as you can just by to kind of structure this underlying and in problem solving as you go to what muscles are swelling up, what muscles are stretching out and flattening out.
Yeah, the main thing is getting all your underlying skeletal structure in place, trying to visualize that, and then you'll know where all your, you know, if you do your research, you know all your muscle groups go. And then once you, you know, get all your scribe lines in place where all your muscle groups are supposed to go, then you can start finessing it, meaning, okay, I know this muscle is going to pop out more. How do I know that? Well, I have a lot of reference that shows this vastus lateralis popping out. I see that my tensor fascia here groups up. And I'm focusing on the back leg a lot, not really focused on the front. The reason is the front legs, there isn't a lot of underlying, like second degree forms. Pretty much what you see is what you get. But with the back leg, there's so many muscles on top of muscles that I want to focus on that so you guys understand the interaction with different muscle groups with each other. With the front, you know, you have your tricep here. Yeah, your bicep over here. Deltoids coming down. Infraspinatus, supraspinatus. You know, it's a spine of the scapula. And there really isn't too much underlying structure to that. So that's a bit easier to grasp. Okay, let's see if I can get to my next tip here. Three. Oh yeah, silhouette. Silhouettes are extremely important because especially films and movie, game, whatever you're doing, you're probably going to have your piece, your animal look, you know, see it from far away. You want it to read as far away as possible. And silhouette is extremely important for that. Let me bring something up here. And silhouette will tell you what's happening with your piece as well. So with ZBrush, it's great. Just use flat color. Is that reading like a dog? You know, how far away? Is it still reading like a dog? Then you move it around and you look at that back leg. Is that working? And if you don't know what you're looking at, then you go back to your see. It's a great view. Look at this silhouette here. You don't know how a leg looks. Look for some reference. You know, I think I found this on Pinterest. Just typed in Weimer on her. See, look at that silhouette. So it's extremely important. It'll tell you, like, you know, if I'm looking at this muscle group here, it'll tell me if this is bulging out too much, if I don't have enough shape to it. So try and incorporate that. Go back and forth with your silhouette. And when you're looking at your reference, always look at these silhouettes, because it'll tell people what your sculpture is way before you start doing your little detail work. Bring up a great sculptor here. Here's a Rembrandt Bugatti. See, there's not much going on there. It's hardly anything. It's just kind of, but if you step back, look at this silhouette. The silhouette is spot on. Where is he at here?
And do you have any advice, Steve, for, you know, you're working for a company like Blizzard, or you're working for a game studio, and they want you to really dramatize, you know, we want to take this canine and make it a 400-pound, you know, aggressive dog. Like, are you still using the same principles? Is there certain muscle groups you're going to be paying attention to? Like, how do you kind of break away from realism? I don't know if that's the right way to put it necessarily, but how do you exaggerate?
With, where's that horse? Let's bring up the dragon here. So this is, you can probably sense that this is kind of from a dog basic anatomy. And when you're exaggerating or when you punch it up, first you gotta, you know, tell yourself, well, what kind of creature am I creating? But, like here, you know, I kind of made some stuff up. Like, you can still see where I have the basic dog structure here. But then I kind of veered from it and maybe put a little, like, a horse anatomy back here. And then just kind of punched up his paws into kind of like, almost like raptor type of thing. But when you're mixing and matching and creating your creatures, you want to think about the overall design. Make sure it's flowing. Make sure it feels right. Like, make sure that, you know, the length of the legs makes sense. It's, you know, even though it's a creature, it still needs to make sense. And you can mix and match your anatomy. Let me bring it up. I mean, let's say you have like here's a bone, here's a bone. You're going to need something to move that. So you're going to have a muscle here, pulling it back and forth. You have a muscle here, it's going to pull it this way. So you can create your own anatomy by understanding all the basic anatomy, you know, I hope you guys learn. And that way you'll be able to mix and match and move these muscles around to where it makes sense. So, let's see. try and do a, see if I can do a quick demo. Let's start on this demo. So, all right, so I want to do, this picture up here. So I want to do this deer on the left here. I want to do that. First thing I would do, kind of map out the overall shape, the silhouette, the basic structure where all the scapula, where all the muscles go. Get the scapula, I get my hips, get my patella, joints, all that figured out, feeling it out. And I start with a basic Z brush, you know, symmetry pose here. Then I start manipulating it, get into this kind of pose. It's real basic. And get a little more detailed. So once I'm at this level, I'm starting to look at my my silhouette some more. You know, looking at my picture, you guys can either use you know, your see-through or your reference image, bring it into background. I try and, normally I have like two screens. I'll have my reference here and my sculpture here. And the reason I do that is because I tend to do it the hard way. Because I don't want to trace. I try and use my hand-eye coordination to look at that, remember it, and bring it over here. And I recommend, I know you guys can't do that all the time for work and everything, but really give it a shot. You know, really try and train your hand-eye coordination and memorization. Because it's only going to make you a better artist. And then you'll be able to recount and regurgitate that knowledge. Because right here I'm putting in my muscle groups, got my deltoids. And my tricep. My lat. Any other questions while I'm working on this? My bicep. Serratus going up here.
So for your dragon that you showed just a bit ago, I saw some kind of studs on the ribcage. What would that exactly be part of? Like, was that part of the ribcage itself? Is it a bone, muscle, tissue?
I'm sorry, I can't understand that.
If you go to the model of your dragon that you showed us a bit ago,
The dragon here?
Yeah, I saw some things on the ribcage there, like some studs that are sticking out. What would that be based off of? Are those actual bones themselves?
These little nubs here?
Yeah.
Actually, I base that on, because in a dog and a lot of other animals, you have your bone here, and then the bottom part starts to be cartilage. And so, let's see if I can pull up a dog here. So right here is where the bone stops and the cartilage starts, comes down here, and there's kind of like this transition where it gets a little thicker, and you're going to see like some bumps here. And I thought that was a good spot to place, you know, some extra stuff, and it gives it a nice like feel because it goes with the actual anatomy. So that's a good point you raised, because you want to look at the anatomy and try and, if you're going to mess with it, try and blend with it. Like, I think those spikes wouldn't have been near as effective if they were up here. I think they flow with the anatomy, hence, you know, it feels more believable. So does that,
yeah, that
help?
Yeah, it helps.
And here's a good, this is, I think, men's sculpture. You can see here where he really defined the separation. So that's really, you can see he's kind of really pushed and pulled the shapes, exaggerated somewhat, and it gives it a nice design feel to it. So that's where those, that's why those came there. I thought it was a real easy spot to incorporate something like that. Any other questions?
In the application of like entry level practice, what would you think are some of the most beneficial ways to apply like early acquisition of the knowledge? Like a lot of master copies or creating your own creatures, or how would you apply it?
All right, so let's say you're starting out. Like, okay, first year art student, I want to learn about animals. One of the first things you do is try and buy as many books as you can on anatomy. Maybe buy one of these. Just saying. But you really want to start gathering all the info you can. Just try and like mass it all together. And once you have that, a good thing to do is maybe pick one of the master sculptures. Maybe go to a museum, and you can take. I would take your own pictures in the round, try and get as many as you can, and copy it, because that way you're gonna feel how he made it. You start understanding when you actually see it and you're putting your hand to it, and you're really gonna get a grasp of it. And that's what I would do first. Gather as much reference as you can on the anatomy. Maybe do a master copy, or take, do a static pose, like an écorché, like just the muscle groups. And I think that's a good starting point. Do both of those. Do like an anatomy study and a master copy. And then once you do that, that's probably what I would do if I had a creature class. You probably wouldn't sculpt a creature till like second semester, because I'd have you doing anatomy the whole time. You'd probably hate me. But I really want you guys to really get a real deep understanding of the anatomy. And I'm hoping I'm getting across it's not too hard. You just break it down into shapes. Like here's a scapula. Got that shape. And you have your reference, like right here, you're looking at it. Okay, I see there's a spine of the scapula. Here's a muscle group here, a muscle group here. Okay, I see some muscles over here, something's going on. Another muscle group's coming down here. You don't have to know the names, just get a feel for where everything's placed. And I see another guy coming over this way. And I'm just using my clay brush, just kind of building things out. But I'm not doing it haphazardly. I'm thinking about it. So I got my lat coming over here. It's my rib cage. Have my obliques coming down this way. Stifle fold right here. Just kind of blob them into shape, into position.
If anyone has any questions, just go ahead and raise your hand, stand up, and I'll come to you with a mic so we can hear you.
Got my rhomboid here. And when I'm doing this, like the picture I had up, you're not going to see the neck muscles. All you see is the fur here. What I like to do, even if I'm going to do fur later, I block in the basic anatomy first, and then I put my fur in. So let's say I got this dog here, and it's going to be like a, like some sort of husky or something. Might want to do it on another layer. I tend to not use layers too much. So I'm just going to, just start blocking in the, even though you're never going to see that anatomy, for me personally, I just like to feel it, understand where it's at for myself.
Quick question. When starting a new project, how much time do you set yourself with the research before you start the project? And how much time do you give the project manager to set a deadline?
I would give myself, if I'm doing an animal, it shouldn't take me too long. Give yourself a half a day, a couple hours, maybe a day. And if you're having trouble, maybe a couple days if you have to like order a book or something, but it shouldn't take you too long. You go on Google. Let's say you want to do this a husky here. Type in husky. Get it. Just rip out here. Actually, here's a good example. I was going to do something with a. Where's that at? With a frog. And this is about, about an hour or so of lifting stuff and off the internet. And sorry, I'm probably gonna, don't like lifting stuff, but what are you gonna do?
I like that you brought it up, because one of the things that we deal with here at the school is we do teach plugins for fur, and of course we go through every way to do kind of hair and fur in games or however it may be. But a lot of times you maybe have had this experience yourself, when you're working with a client, the client doesn't always want you to use a plugin, can't always use the plugin themselves. Sometimes you just have to get in there and muscle out and model out the fur. Do you have any quick tips? Do you have any quick advice on getting good at modeling fur as opposed to using a plugin or using a workaround, just having to go in there and kind of do it by hand?
Yeah. Let me see. Break down this.
I realize there may not be a short answer to that, but
no. The main thing about fur, I hope I didn't jam this up, is. Oops. It's the flow of it. Like, when the dog here, you want to know. Look at your reference. I don't have any fur reference, but first scribe in your lines if you want to draw over your reference. Get the direction of all the fur. Like this guy, it's going to come over like this. Then it's going to come down. Maybe it might be some tufting back up that way. And there's actually some good fur reference in some of the anatomy books. I said they show you which way the fur goes, but for sculpting it, a good trick I use is I block out the mass, and then you just take any, you know, I just have my standard alpha here. I just kind of punch holes in it.
Nice.
Try and feel out the overall shape. And that, you know, and at work they love, you know, they love to do like every single strand. I can't stand it. But I like to just do like a basic mass. And another thing about fur is try not to get this stuff too similar, the different ins and outs, like break it up. And then once you have like some depressions there to create, you know, some feel for it, some depth, then you can go in. Then you can go in over top of it and start doing some more detailed strand work.
You make it look easy.
And good reference for this type of thing is go to the Met Museum website. That's the New York Met, Metropolitan Museum of Art. Try and find their European sculpture section. And there's some 18th century busts of like these really gaudy guys with those wigs, and you see in the marble how they just drill in holes in different spots. That's where I learned this process, looking at those sculptures. They just dig in. They have the mass, this huge mass, and then they'll just dig in very, you know, selectively. Here, let me go back a sec here. And yeah, so that, definitely check that out. You want to see how like bushy hair is? Definitely check that out. And with animals, you're gonna have some like areas where it's gonna stop like this. You're gonna have a line. You wanna feel out that line where the fur kind of stops and then another starts, like a different muscle group. You dig in some of these negatives here. And it'll start discerning that line, kind of break it up so it's not too even. And I like using my clay tubes brush as well. You can really lay out some quick. And all the while I'm feeling out where the flow of the fur is going. So does that help with fur?
That's awesome. one of the other questions we had, maybe jumping ahead, so what about age? Is there a way that you can kind of quickly establish age?
Age?
Young versus old?
As far as animals? Well, a good rule of thumb is most animals, as they age, the withers, break up the horse here. This area right here, this starts to shrink. And you start seeing like this you start seeing more of the backbone and starts having more of a concave look to it. And the glutes start coming down this way and you start seeing more of the pelvis underneath. And his back will drop. And all this really punched up muscle will get thinner. Let me see if I can, I think I have a deer. See this deer, you see how this kind of falls off and it's not a healthy deer. This would be much fuller right in this area, much fuller. And it's falling off there where you can just see the backbone. So that's a real good key to make something look old, like this area right in here. Like this would droop down, this would be thinner, and that's a good simple way to just make him look a little older.
You were talking earlier about these busts at the Met. Other than I've seen like the work of Antoine Louis Barye before at the Met and the Louvre and. I think that he even has something at the Getty. What are other animal sculptors that you would recommend that looking at their work?
So you wanted to talk about animals at the Met?
Or just any good animal sculptor that you recommend?
Well, pretty much any animal you can find there is, I mean, I've taken, luckily I'm close to it, and I used to go there practically every week. I think I have a couple thousand pictures from that place, but I have, let me see it here. This is Anna Hyatt Huntington, and you want to talk about pushing and pulling and squash and stretch and really pushing it. This is in the, I forget the name of this room, it's like the great room of, can't miss it, it's a big atrium, but look at that leg. Look at those legs and see the vastus really punching out here. You can make out the pelvis. There's your glute wrapping around. There's your bicep right here. She gets a little kind of a little more exaggerated here with the muscle groups, but really great. You can see this bear in the background. I think that's Paul Manship. Really stylized, beautiful stuff. This is Isidore Bonheur. He's French, I don't know how to pronounce his name. You probably saw his horse sculpture around. It's probably it's what inspired me to do all this sculpture. It's the Ecrochet horse from 19th century. But, you know, this would be a great sculpture to, practice from, take a bunch of pictures of that. But back to the Met, the 18th, the European 18th or 19th century room, tons of great sculpture. The sculpture is kind of spread out throughout the whole museum. But it's just chock full, and they have a really good website. They put it all online for everybody, so have fun with that. You can spend hours checking that stuff out. So I hope that helps with finding stuff at the Met.
I see that you do static poses and also some that are animated. For your workflow, do you pretty much do a static pose and then go on with your model, and these more animated poses are for kind of fun and reference and kind of understanding how the animal moves?
For when I start like this this deer, I'll start it with something like this. Then I'll turn off my symmetry. I know a lot of people that'll freak them out. But and then I just start posing them into the pose I want. And if you guys are good at rigging, you know, you can make your own rigs and pose it. But I would recommend doing it this way in your spare time. You know, you might not be able to do this long way at work, but this way, you know, you pose it, and then you don't have a skeleton underneath. Like when you know, if you have a rig, you can, you know, skin it, put stuff over top of it, and you can have it underneath, so you can keep your skeletal group in shape, so you're not going off the deep end and have to keep recalibrating and figuring out where all your muscle groups are. But try this way with no armature underneath, because it'll just help you in the long run. You know, it's learning. Think of it as a learning exercise. And so that's how I do it. And then, you know.
Steve, do you have any examples? This is going back a little bit to kind of referencing or appreciation, maybe. Sometimes appreciation is something in schools that doesn't get talked about as much. But as your eye has developed over the years, you've been doing this for a long time, as your eye has developed, have you gone into museums and seen some of these statues or sculptures for the first time, kind of looking at them and saying that, oh, now I can actually appreciate what the artist is doing. I can actually appreciate the extremes that he's pushing us to. Is that something that's happened to you? Do you find that's happened in your own career where you have to have an eye to actually be able to see sometimes the value in some of these?
Yeah, I like with that Anahia Huntington one, like I was like, oh, that's neat, whatever. But then when I understood anatomy, like, oh, okay, I get it. I can break it down myself. I can see it, and I can appreciate it more, and I can understand it. But you know, if you're just starting, you're like, oh wow, you know, where do you even start? How does she even begin to know how to do that? Like I was saying, you break it down. You know, you figure out where the pivot points are. Get your pelvis, get your shoulder blades, get your, right there's a patella, right there's a femur, right there's a tibia, there's the tibial band, or the patellar band. And you know, you start breaking it down. There's an ischium back there. And then you're like, it's you can demystify it. It's not, you know, they're not magicians. And you know, you just try and break it down, like, you know, here's this guy, this is some crazy, really stylized, talk about fur. You can really see how he broke it up, really stylized it, see how it's flowing. But you can still, he punched in where the basic muscle groups are as well. So you're not losing it. It doesn't just look like a big fur ball. You know, you can see where the vastus lateralis is. You can see the gastrocnemius right here. You can feel it out. And this fur is going the way of the muscle groups too up here. So.
Do you ever find real anatomy feeling unrealistic in the final design?
I'm sorry, what?
Do you ever find real anatomy feeling unrealistic in the final design?
I couldn't understand that.
Like, for example, let's say you're making a deer for a film, and you're keeping the anatomy as realistic as possible, or as real as possible, but the final design of the deer, when it ends up looking on screen, it feels unrealistic to the casual observer. So you have to stylize or maybe modify some of the anatomy. Does that kind of make sense, what I'm asking?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I couldn't hear some of that.
Say it one time.
Okay. I'll just say it out loud. Do you ever find that real anatomy feels unrealistic in the final design of the creature, even if it's a real creature?
So are there things in film that, for example, maybe tell me if I'm hitting your question right or not, a goblin shark, the way that its jaws shoot out of its face, so to speak. If you're unfamiliar with that and you see that in a movie, it may seem kind of ridiculous. Maybe it is at extremes, that kind of close. Are there things that...
Like, for example, like if you were to put sometimes an actual real explosion on film, it would look completely unrealistic.
Mm-hmm.
So the audience is used to sort of the CGI representation of the actual explosion.
Yeah, yeah.
So they don't feel that real footage is real. And so kind of the same thing maybe in regards to animal anatomy, where like you have to actually simplify forms because otherwise the audience feels that it's unreal because it's actually real.
Mm-hmm.
Perception
versus
reality.
Let's say you're creating an asset for a movie. Clearly, it's not going to look like this. You know, you want a dog. Like you're saying, you do need to simplify it, break it down, so it's more realistic. Because a real dog, you know, this stuff is all going to be. You're not going to see any of this stuff. You're just going to see the basic shapes. But also for film and whatnot, you know, you're an artist. You're not, you know, if you didn't need artists, you could just scan a dog or a deer, and it's going to look dead. There's something that the artist can do. Like, you can enhance these muscle groups a little more just to make it look a little more alive. Like if this was taxidermy or like just a regular dog, this would be washed out so much you'd hardly see any of this stuff. So you just want to, for me personally, I like to pump it up just a little bit. You know, I've been accused of everything looks like everything, you know, all my animals are bodybuilders. I can't help it. I just like punching it up to make it like almost hyper real. But you got to watch that. You know, you got to gauge where how far you can push that. But does that answer the question? See, so I would, you know, soften all this up, and you can put your maps on. Like you wouldn't see. The pectorals down here at all, practically, they would disappear. You wouldn't see the rib cage like it is.
Kind of building on that last question, in human anatomy, usually like you can get away with stuff like elongating forearms or elongating calves, and they still look aesthetically pleasing. What is there something about animals that you can exaggerate that you can get with that does make it look good?
Yeah, that's tricky. Because I always draw, when I'm doing people, the arms are always longer, and the heads are always smaller. You can get away with that. With animals, what I tend to do is I always make them wider than they are. It just feels better to me. It has more mass. When it comes to the legs, you really can't mess with that if you want to do something, if you want to do a dog that looks like a dog. You really can't do anything with the length of the legs or the neck. Can't elongate the neck because it's just going to look completely different. I mean, if that's what you want, that's fine. But yeah, it's very tricky with animals. You got to be very careful. And pretty much the only thing I exaggerate is my width here, and I'll make rib cages deeper just because it makes them look more muscular to me. Again, I can't help myself. And just punching up the muscles just a tad. And let's say you're at a point where you got all your muscle groups and you know, you feel like you're getting it. You want to punch it up a notch. Go into transition areas. Just kind of dig it in a little deeper. Just to exaggerate that area. So does that help? Any other questions?
Sec, I'll be right over there.
Sorry, I'm not getting very far with this demo.
I think you're giving some valuable information.
You touched earlier on how you can reference similar animal anatomy, like the different ungulates and how they relate to each other. Getting more into your fantasy creatures, is there anything that you think just shouldn't be combined ever? Kind of like you had the dog, but it was reinforced with horse anatomy.
I think it's wide open. Go for it. You want to put a jellyfish with a deer? Knock yourself out. But understand, you know, basic design sense. It's really important to get flow and the sense of movement proper, proportions. So you can have a deer, you know. You want to have tentacles, jellyfish tentacles coming off his neck here. Maybe even have like a jellyfish sack underneath his, you know, underneath his chin like that. It's, yeah, I think all bets are off. You know, as long as, you know, the design feels right, yeah, I think you can try and mix and match anything you can get your hands on. Give it a shot.
I've always
yeah, and I think the weirder the better. Like, you know, give yourself, you know, make some cards up of different animals. You know, mix them up and flip them over and then put two together and see, you know, give yourself a test. Can I merge those two? You know, that's something fun I've done a few times where I've kind of give myself some little tests, see how what I can do with the cards I'm dealt.
Are there As you're viewing other people's work or taking a look at work or presented with work, are there common anatomical mistakes that you're seeing, whether it be in the forearms, neck structures, anything that kind of routinely comes up where it's clear to see the artist doesn't have a good understanding?
Every time that I have issues, it always involves the knees. you know, the joints. It always, it's really tricky. It's a hard area. There's a lot going on here. There's a lot of muscles coming and going. There's a lot of muscle groups moving. And it's really not that hard if you break it down. Figure out where your kneecap is, your patella. Figure out where your femur is. Get your tibia straightened out. Get your ligament here. You know, get those in the right place. Then go off and do your muscle groups. But, you know, so many times, I see stuff from a T-pose, and they bendy it up. I like to call it, you know, they put your mask on here. And like, okay, that's good enough. I'm done. And like, no, get it cleaned up. Yeah, get your bones worked out. So yeah, it's. The joints are the key. You spend your time, get your joints right, get them measured correctly, and the whole piece will start to come together. Because if you understand this area, the hardest area in my view, all this other stuff's cake. You know, like this, you know, it's a pretty simple shape. This is a simple shape. Got your rib cage here. Okay, I know my lat goes over here. Trapezius, You know, those are all pretty much simple shapes, but if you can get your joints right, like this tricep, gonna do the squash and stretch again. You know, it's gonna push and pull here, and you're gonna have to understand the skeletal structure underneath. Because bring it up here. If I have it up, no, okay. You see how this comes up here? So your tricep's gonna attach here. It's going to loop around like that. Just get all this stuff, you know, even if it's just a simple, you know, rectangle, if you're having trouble, just get it, you know, build up a simple rectangle armature underneath if you're having trouble, and get this mapped out. Once this is done, you know, get this in right relationship to this. And once you have that, It makes it so much better. Instead of this, it looks like, you know, Gumby joints and things. And I can't express how important the joints are. I could spend 2 hours just talking about the joints. I don't want to put anyone to sleep.
Steve, we've got a few questions online for Crystal here. Here, I'm going to hand it to Crystal.
Hey, so we had someone watching on the live stream who wanted to ask, how do you know where to add fat deposits on anatomical studies that aren't shown on muscle and skeletal charts? And how would you go about placing fat deposits on fantastical creatures so they look realistic?
Fat deposits, let's find a horse here. See a static pose. Let me bring it in Photoshop. So you want to learn about fat deposits. Good thing is to look at a real animal where fat deposits are. Like this right here, this is, see how this is at rest? Let me get a new layer. This is, part of this is fat right here above the patella. And, you know, let's say you want to do fat, like I guess I'm assuming a fat horse. It's pretty simple, you know. But don't just, you know, mound it out. Feel out where the guts are and everything, because here's your rib cage. You're not going to bulge this area out because it's ribs. It can't push out there. You're going to have to push it out from here to around here. So think about your basic anatomy and work around that. This is not fat, that's a gland right there. So, and looking at human anatomy too helps where you want to put some fat deposits. But, yeah, it's, you know, if you're doing creatures, it's kind of a free-for-all, but just keep in mind your basic anatomy. If I wanted to make this guy fat, I would start. Oops. I'd bulge this area out. And looking at older cats, older house cats. It's probably pretty good. You have these kind of hang bellies. But animals, generally, they don't really get much fat around here. I mean, you might want to, maybe you can bulge out a neck, make it fat. So necks, bellies, yeah, it's, you know, look at the natural world. Look at older animals. Look at overweight animals. See where it's accumulating, and then just kind of go from there. But again, think about design too. See how this kind of goes up and then straight here? Maybe I want to bring that down. So it kind of have a nice little curve to it. You know, always think about the silhouette and the design sense as well. So I hope that helps with fat deposits.
Quick question. What was the craziest combination you ever had to do for a project? Did it work out for you as your initial design? And if it didn't, how do you deal with a complicated director in a company like that? Humanoid platypus example.
I'm coming out of left field. I don't really work in the industry anymore. But the stuff I did for Oddworld Inhabitants back in the day, I think I worked on second or third game. Lauren Lanning, the owner, he had some really wild ideas. So I think I have a picture of part of one here. Give me a sec. Bad picture. That's before digital cameras, guys. So he wanted like some fish aspects, lizard. He threw in all kinds of stuff. So this guy and another one I did for him really, really were wild. He has four arms here. So I had to come up with trying to figure out the anatomy of how four arms worked. But his stuff was pretty wild. He really wanted some crazy combos. I don't remember exactly what the combos were. I just remember the final outcome was pretty trippy. But yeah, that was probably the craziest stuff I've done.
How many iterations is what you're asking?
For that particular piece from Oddworld, they had really good ref. The designer for that did some really good drawings, so I didn't actually, was it that one? No, it's another one there was drawing from. He just kind of let me run with that one. One of his main things was it needs to be believable. I need to feel like this thing could be walking around right now. And so that was my task, you know. It had to have the four arms. It had to have that basic look. But he's like, you figure out the anatomy. You know, I don't understand it. You figure it out. And back then, it was a little trickier getting info back and forth. That was pretty much the start of the internet. So,
Steve, yikes. We've got about 10 more minutes, but... do you have any advice for up-and-coming artists, junior artists, or artists in general? And what are some of the challenges for you moving forward? What inspires you? What challenges you? And maybe you can tell us a little bit something about your sculpts as well. I think we're going to auction a few of those off, but I think those are amazing resources for artists. So if you can maybe hit on a few of those points.
I'm sorry.
So portfolio advice for artists coming up? Any advice you
have? If I was looking at a portfolio, well, before the portfolio, like I said before, either have an animal in an action pose or static, have an écorché so you know your employer can see that you understand anatomy and how it's working. And maybe, let's say you do a horse. Take that horse and then turn it into something else so he can see that the progression of how you can take literal, actual anatomy and transform it. That might be good. But if I was looking at a portfolio, I would like to see that. Like to see some fur, like to see how you interact with fur. But just a basic understanding of the anatomy and then the subtleties that go with it. I see a lot of guys, they get the anatomy, but then they miss the skin nuances. You know, just the subtleties. You know, they get, you know, really heavy-handed with, you know, getting the anatomy. It's like, okay, great. You know, the thing has to breathe now. You know, I don't want to touch too much on detail work, but you know, the veins and you know the skin textures do sell a piece. So once you get your anatomy, make sure you get that. Then you know you can go do your candy and do all this kind of fun stuff. But be subtle about it. Don't be heavy-handed. You know, don't you know make your veins look like big ropes. You know, they you know have them coming in and out. I like to use my inflate brush with this alpha.
And it's actually nice to say that you're kind of a master of anatomy because you've got the mileage to prove that. But what do you find some of the challenges moving forward for yourself are? Or what kind of inspires you? What pushes you? What do you feel challenged by now that you feel like you've got a fairly good grasp on anatomy?
Right now, I'm trying to dig even deeper with understanding how the anatomy works during movement. This is something I'm working on right now. Find it. It's a canter series. And I learned a lot doing this because there, you know, these muscle groups, there's a lot going on, a lot of changes. And when you're doing this, you're starting to feel like, you know, this is good for, you know, animators too. You're really feeling the movement. And so I'm just trying to, for myself personally, just dig deeper, more and more, getting to understand and feel how muscles work when they're moving. And you know, someone might say, oh, why even bother with this stuff? Weta has an amazing, you know, muscle program that simulates all this stuff. And I'll say to that, again, you know, do you want to be a technician or you want to be an artist? And there's always going to be a need for a guy who really understands this stuff because, you know, if you're getting churned out knowing the programs again and not having the basics, you know, you're going to be left behind for the guy who spent a little extra time to understand how this stuff works. So I'd really encourage you guys to, you know, keep going with the anatomy and don't be scared by it. You know, take it step by step, block it out, simple shapes, and yeah, have fun with it. It shouldn't be a chore, you know, to work on anatomy. A lot of guys are like, oh, gotta do that anatomy. I just want to get to my textures. It's like, it should be a fun part of it, so.
Quickly, you touched on the value in fine art, recognizing the value in fine art studies. Are there any more popular culture resources that have any special value in anatomy, or any of your favorite popular culture projects that have really gotten it down?
You mean like movies or?
Yeah, just
like any cool creatures that I liked.
Yeah.
I thought the creatures in the first remake of that new Star Wars series, I thought they were pretty cool. I thought they were really believable. That, especially that snow kind of monster, is kind of like an offshoot of a polar bear type of thing with the teeth. I thought that was a pretty nice design. Felt really believable. And the gait of it, I thought, looked nice. It's another thing for the animators, really look at, you know, the gaits of the animals too, because the audience will sense, because like, oh, I've seen that before, it'll click. And you know, if you try and come up with some different type of gait, they're like, yeah, it doesn't work, and you might lose them. So really focus on the natural world like that.
Okay, we got time for about one more question here real quick. Anybody? All right. Nice round of applause for Steve, everyone. So I love that you took time to answer all those questions. Those are great.
I was a little all over the place, so I, you know, but I hope it helped out.
That's awesome. I would love for you to share with everybody what you're doing with your models, though, and give them a little bit of information for that, because I think these are super special. I'm going to leave it to you to kind of discuss that.
It's been in the works for a couple years now, and I started these models for myself because I'm like, can't find what I need. I'm a sculptor. Why don't I just make it myself? So the deer was the first one, and it's more of a anatomy sketch. It's not a pure écorché, but I use it actually for myself all the time, and it's a really great reference to have. And it's, and the dog is a little pushed a little further, but I think they're great to have. And I personally, I mean, I did it for myself at first, and I'm like, other people might want it, and it's just a great reference, you know, to see it sitting there. You can pick it up, you know, look at all different angles. You can see check out silhouettes.
Yeah, I told Steve when he first just got here. Let me pull this up really quickly. We're going to give you this bag. We're going to have you draw out two tickets, if you will, because we're going to give two of those away, which I think is amazing of Steve to do. But this is actual ear form from a real elk or deer, basically. And this morning when these came in, I took a look at it, and I'm like looking at this actual cast from a live one, and I'm looking at the little tiny ears, and all these little subtle muscle groups in here are all on that model. And I'm just like, what a badass. So if you get the opportunity, are these going to be on sale on your site anytime soon? Or?
Yeah, I think I have a sign-up sheet if anyone's interested out there. It's a deer, and it's going to have a metal armature for the legs, and there's going to be two versions of the dog. The dog version is going to have one with an armature for the legs, and another version without the armature that's a little less expensive. But they're going to range between, like, I think 148 and 129, I believe. But if you're interested in info when they're coming out, I should be having them available in the next couple weeks. So
definitely pick them up.
And there's going to be more to come. I have a bunch in the works, different animals. So, and we're going to, was there dogs in the box?
There
too?
Is. We're going to
go. So you're going to give
we're going to bring this up right now.
You're going to give one deer and one dog, right? Correct? Yeah. So, all right. So I got two of these. Here are the tickets. So I call them out. It's 139775. And I don't know who's getting what with what ticket. And 139837. Sweet. I think there's, are the antlers in the box? We'll have to go check and see if the ant, but they should be there. So let me, all right, you get a deer, hold on to that. And dog. And I go out and get them at the, out there, so. Yeah, enjoy. So, thanks for coming, everyone. I hope it helped. I wanted to give you something other than just, you know, doing a pretty sculpture. I wanted to give you some guts of something to take home and really, really use. So, thanks.